I'm Ben Scragg, Program Manager for College Ready Ohio, a K-12 higher ed consortium grant at The Ohio State University.
And I'm Angela Gunder, and I'm Senior Instructional Designer for the University of Arizona's online campus, UA Online.
Dave Goodrich, Learning Experience Designer, Michigan State University.
Hey!
All right, we are in, and we are recording once again. So,
as if this was our first time with technology.
That's right. So this has happened now 2 weeks in a row, and the frustrating thing is I've got this Yeti, this really awesome mic that I love, but I just can't get the sound to come through my headphones. So I put on my headset, and it seems to work. I don't like the way I sound.
So I had a moment where I had to leave Zencastr, plug everything in, make sure that my snowball was on, and now I'm good.
Mm.
I don't know if that makes a difference.
It may well make a difference.
Because it did not recognize my snowball right away. Hey, snowball. I gotta talk nerd with you a little bit. First
All
and
right.
foremost. So last week, because I tend to be a lazy gal once in a while, especially when I'm doing something fun, I like to take my time. I decided to use my Logitech headset, and I record in lovely northwestern Tucson, Arizona, facing the Catalina Mountains. And
there
in order
go.
For me to see the mountains, I am looking through a window, which makes for really shitty sound when you're using a Logitech headset. All that. Gorgeous audio bouncing off of glass is just totally awesome. So I showed this to Dave a while back. I think you saw it too, but I have the equivalent of a diorama made of metal.
Mm-hmm.
And it's got foam in the inside of it, and it's portable. And it actually has a mic stand in the middle of it. So I have screwed the head of my snowball mic onto this little portable podcasting booth. And then I have a pop filter on that. And it's fucking magic. It's really what it is. It's witchcraft and magic. So the audio piece, I forget, I have to look up the name, and we can post this somewhere for people, for our two listeners that are listening. We can post this link for them to the diorama-esque thing. But it's basically like a desktop podcasting station. That ran me back $90. My mic was, well, snowballs are snowballs. You can get them for like $60 or $79 now. And then the popping filter was, I think, $5. It was pretty cheap. So for $100, I have the ability to prance around town to record wherever I want to and sound crystal clear, which is pretty epic. But for those of you guys that, I mean, did you feel like $90 is expensive for a mobile podcasting station?
No way. I mean, that's the crazy thing is like, you know, I'm going to go ahead and drop like $140 here on a Yeti, $99 on, I mean, basically every blue USB mic or anything, I'm like, yep, worth it. So at this point, it's like, I could easily justify in my life spending like $400 on like four or five like different mics and knowing that I'm only ever going to use one at one time, right? Or give one to, you know, faculty or something, and like, yeah, you can totally lend that. But like my iPad, I'll give you all semester. My USB mics, I'll lend that to you for 48 hours, and then I'm coming for you. So
I have a fixer that is going to be knocking on your door. give me my mic. Yeah. Where's the mic app? Well, the reason I ask is I thought that was a little bit expensive, but for those of you guys that are out there that might be having sticker shock over $99, they do make similar versions of this for $30. You just don't have the ability to screw your mic into the piece, which is kind of nice. And I can actually hook this whole rig up to a mic stand, so if I wanted to adjust the height of it, because again, if I'm too lazy to adjust my chair hard, I can adjust the little boo thing on the mic stand itself, which is awesome. But this is not my show tonight.
Well, actually, I think it's going to be. I think what I'm going to do is throw out questions, and I'm just going to kind of probe here and there and see where you go, and then try to do the same with Dave tomorrow. So I'm actually going to try to, my approach tonight is to focus maybe a little bit more on my interviewing skills.
Hell yeah.
So I just want to see. So I know Dave had a theme on here, and it had empathy, ideation, design, but I want to hear just a little bit more in depth about, so just tell me, because I don't actually know this, a little bit more about your background and where you got into this. And then I think a question I'm very curious about is just like, what do you love?
Wait, hold it. Save that question.
Go ahead. Save it. Jump in there.
I'm going to get in this. Actually, I have a question for you first, because I want this to be a recurring theme in our podcast. What are you drinking right now?
Oh, a little Henry McKenna 10-year single barrel bottled in bond Kentucky straight bourbon. That's a lot of modifiers. but actually, for about a $30 bottle of bourbon, it's a pretty incredible thing. It's 10 years old, which is if you listen to Parker Beam, who was the master distiller at Heaven Hill Distilleries, where this stuff is made. Heaven Hill, which also makes Elijah Craig and Evan Williams, makes Henry McKenna, has kind of been on the record saying, you know, for him, 10 years is about the sweet spot for bourbon. That's about where he likes his bourbon aged. And bottled in bond is kind of an old signifier of quality. Back probably at the turn of the 20th century, there's a guy named E.H. Taylor who has a bourbon named after himself, who people were going around selling snake oil. And so this guy basically wanted government regulation as a sign of quality and assurance for customers, that they knew what they were getting. And so there are all these standards around how you had to age. And it was literally there's a government bondsman who guards a warehouse where this stuff is aged. So so that only has to be 4 years, I think, 4 years old, but this is 10 single barrel. Pretty good stuff. And for $30, pretty cheap. So anyway, I'm having a
night. Correct me if I'm wrong, like that's what separates bourbon from the other types of whiskey, correct? That it's
the makeup. So bourbon is primarily corn based. It has to be at least 51% corn in the ingredients, or what you would call the mash bill. So like rum, right, is made out of sugar cane, you know, and mostly comes from the Caribbean or tropical places. Historically, vodka was a grain. Some people would say potatoes, or, you know, as wine is grapes, right? So, or gin is just kind of grain, but then you add juniper or citrus or something
gin
like that.
Gin is gasoline.
So, yeah.
Gin is fuel. Nail polish remover.
Yeah, so it's a lot of it is just about 51% corn, and then usually rye or wheat is the second kind of grain in there. So all whiskey generally, whiskey is distilled not that differently than say vodka or gin. It's just you throw whiskey in a barrel, whether it's rye whiskey, Scotch whiskey, Irish whiskey, bourbon, and like rum, you throw it in a barrel and it takes on a little bit of color from the wood.
Thank you for tuning in to Potent Potables Hour with Ben and Angela.
Did I win my James Beard for that?
I don't think that the dead man James Beard is giving out awards for for distillation stories, but he should. He should. We're going to reanimate his corpse, because with science comes better living and better explanations of how alcohol is made and the awards that go with that. Mm. Well, I'm drinking bourbon tonight too, Knob Creek.
There you go.
For easy day drinking, even though it's 6:15 p.m. And
yeah,
I tried to make an old fashioned that was as simple as possible. I understand the two camps of old fashioned. Making the one that, and by the way, this can all be edited out at some point.
Yeah, that's fine. This is going to be part of my bourbon podcasting. This is where I'm going to start. So
barrel to barrel. Mm-hmm. We need to work on a better name for that, because that's the worst name I've ever come up with. So, old fashioned, you have the folks that believe in mashing fruit and sugar at the bottom of a glass and then adding your bourbon and your bitters. And then there are your folks that believe in maybe a single ice cube, bourbon, some sort of very, very light sweetener, maybe even a simple syrup, a zest of a fruit.
Yeah.
And maybe a cherry, but maybe not. And like, certainly not a maraschino cherry. Like, folks are adamant against those. But I did it upright because I believe in this podcast and I believe in the future. So I use some cherries that are soaked in old smoky moonshine so that I can have the most interesting things to say this evening.
Yeah, I like where you're at right there. So Manhattans and old fashions at this point are pretty much out of laziness where I go for cocktails. I think about once every 2 months I'll get on one and decide on a weekend I'm going to go out to the store and buy some kind of wild ingredients and mix some juices and make some syrups or do a cocktail day. And then
some tinctures.
That's right. And I look at all the I look at all the mess I've made on my bar and I'm like, I don't need to stray. I'm good. So yeah.
Keep it simple. Well, I can craft a story about not keeping it simple and how I got into instructional design. Look at me bringing it back.
Yep.
I talk a lot, about how instructional designers, or at least the core of instructional designers that are really active. It's not an age thing. I don't think it has to do with age per se. I just think that the folks that are really crushing it right now in the online realm, they all have a similar story, if not a more fascinating one than mine. But I feel as if we're all career switchers in one way, shape, or form. And that term has negative connotations in some realms. But in ours, I think it's highly important. It's what makes our work as practitioners as strong, robust, and agile as it needs to be. That we didn't start out our undergrad career saying, I'm going to be an instructional designer.
Yeah.
And I'm going to wear all of the hats that come with that. I think it's also interesting that you, Dave, and I do similar things, but we all have very different titles. And ID kind of becomes a catch-all for it. But even the title itself is morphing and changing, which I'm excited about. But my story began, I'm the daughter of a polyglot, of a language professor, and of an engineer. My father is an electrical engineer and a musician. He's an accomplished Piedmont blues musician from the 1920s and 30s.
Right,
All sorts of awesomeness there. We're in love with music. We're in love with words. We're in love with ideas, storytelling. All of those threads are passions of everybody within our immediate family. And for me, I thought that my story was going to be that I would become a geneticist because I was always fascinated with science and, to a certain extent, art. I went to Fordham for my undergrad. And when I started at Fordham, I was sure that science was the way that I was going to go. I had come in as a sophomore with all of my AP credits. I was prepared. I was ready. I had my plan. And then through some advising snafus, I was told that in order to stay in the program that I was in, because I missed an important class that I needed to take, even though I was signed off and totally approved for me to do what I was going to do, I was going to be a year behind. So going from a year ahead to a year behind and feeling kind of like a failure for that, even though I didn't really have anything to do with that whole process, which is a right. totally separate story of how people's mistakes in higher ed can often become the turning point in an individual story, which is fascinating to me. So I went back to my dorm room. I was really disheartened. And my best friend, who is truly my sister from another mister, still my best friend, said to me, "Hey, you're making websites for nonprofits back in Washington, D.C., where you're from, as a side gig. Why aren't you studying that? Why are you studying pre-med when you've been already working as a web designer for how many years? And you seem to really care about it and love it." And a light bulb went off. I mean, she was my advisor. She was that, if we're looking at Joseph Campbell's monomyth,
yeah.
She was the wise elder. She was the mentor that sent me on my journey, gave me that little bit of knowledge of, hey, dummy, you can actually study what you're already doing for a living. And off I went. And they didn't have web design back then, and it's not even that long ago. I mean, we're talking about 2001, maybe, that this was when I made the switch. They didn't have it. So I said, what's the next best thing? I'm going to be computer science, and I'll be a studio art minor. So I'm going to get to program and paint. And what the universe did not tell me until years later was that the best thing that you can do as a web designer is learn all of the logic that comes from learning programming and all of the visual communication pieces that come from fine art. The web design stuff will come later. You'll learn it on the job. You'll learn Photoshop. You'll learn Dreamweaver. You'll learn all of the programming languages that didn't even exist at that time when you get in there on the job. But those fundamentals of how we think, of how we users think when we interact with systems, when we see pretty shiny things in front of us and all of the things that we hate, they've been teaching folks that for years and years and years. So again, I fell into all of that mistakenly. Fast forward several years, I ended up as the webmaster for the City College of New York, and I was responsible. We did like a page inventory. It was something to the tune of 40,000 unique web pages, and we had a little under 1,000 different content editors that were putting their hands on all of the different pages that were on the site. And most people would think with a title that had to do with web mistressry, that it would be a lot of programming. But in actuality, it was being able to communicate with folks, being able to speak to them in their language and then translate that into a visual language, into a programming language, and make sure that what they were saying was the was what they wanted to communicate to their stakeholders. So go ahead.
The other thing I'm going to do tonight is, as I catch snippets of things that I I don't know, maybe this is a bad way to listen, but so you've just captured me. I go back and forth all the time about, depending on which way the wind is blowing, you'll catch me on which different, I really want to jump into a PhD program. And at this point, like, the reasons are so multifaceted, like, probably at least a third of it is vanity / pride / there's this other piece of, like, something I just always thought I was going to do, like, kind of maybe destiny kind of deal. Like, maybe I'm a little bit like my dad did it, and that was just like such a, he did that when I was in high school. Like, he retired from being a principal and finished that. And it was like such this, I'm just now realizing, like, this big thing in my mind, like, to see how hard he worked at it was like, that is the standard of, like, how, what you should do with your life. Mm-hmm. Which maybe we should devote some time to, because I'm just now reflecting on that. But then, like, depending on the day, you catch me in, like, what I want to do. But a lot of times I'm like, nah, man, just go get a master's degree in design, because that's what you want to do, right? Like, visual design. I'm finding more like the design of things, and, like, you know, all of these books that I come across, like the design of everyday things and stuff, like, that stuff is incredible, because if you have those skills, then you can do anything, right? And so I don't know, I think about, like, should I try to just, like, create my own PhD program in the College of Ed that's half visual design? And so I wonder, because I know you've got you're in that vein with those skills, and I just wonder how, and you may have already said this and I was lost in my own navel gazing, but, like, how has that helped you see education by just having that skill set or even affinity for the design of things?
I think it is, it's changed the relationship between the consumer or the student, and I mean it in a very affectionate way to call the student a consumer, as in they're digesting knowledge, not that they're just somebody out there spending money. But I think it changes the relationship between the consumer and then the space that they learn in. So if we're all able to communicate, and we have many tools in our Swiss Army knife to communicate with, some of them being visual, some of them being verbal, and we can use them in unique and different ways. And sometimes we have to fight against them in order to get what we need to get. It's a sobering and an empowering look at how we approach education. So I'll give you an example. When we talk about the value of higher education, and we talk about the value of those traditional experiences as we see them, the learning content itself has been a commodity that has been wholly accessible to us for a very long time. The internet flattened that. All of that is there and it's available. Yeah. But it's not contextualized for us. It's not linked together to the other things that matter. It's not curated. It's not reframed. And also, more importantly, it's not turned for us so that we understand that we're supposed to ask questions and we're supposed to question all of that that's out there that is being lauded as truth. So even though theories and research and data and all of this is out there, we don't need to go to a classroom in order to learn it. The value of the educator becomes that mentor leading you on that journey, just like I took that journey when somebody gave me a little bit of information, them saying, okay, all of these facts are out here, but you really need to pay attention to this particular fact. And you need to start asking yourselves these questions, and you need to create knowledge that will serve as answers to these questions. And for me, because of the nature of how fine art has been taught, and particularly studio art, where you're in an open critique environment, an open studio lab environment, that's all built into the education. So I think that we have a lot to learn from that particular structure of saying, you know what, there is no one path. We're all going to meet the articulated outcomes, but we're all going to do it in different ways. And as we progress along this journey, we're going to stop. We're going to look at everybody's work that's around us. We're going to talk about it in a respectful way, but we're going to break it down into pieces. And that's what I would argue all education should be like. And it shouldn't matter what the discipline is, and it shouldn't matter the modality. It shouldn't matter whether you're in an asynchronous or a synchronous experience. You should be able to simultaneously go on this journey with your peers, with each of our journeys being highly personalized, but also highly collaborative, that we're all creating knowledge and feeding each other with new new knowledge as we go along. It's a lot. I know.
That's such a lot to chew through, right? I'm gonna play this back, and then we're gonna have follow up conversations on that.
Well, and we should, because I think my struggle now is how do I take that lightning in a bottle and help a math instructor create that same experience, or help a chemistry instructor create that same experience. I'm not trying to pick on STEM right now, but but you know, just looking at all the different disciplines that come before us, and giving educators the tools that they need to make sure that the student feels like they have agency over their process. I kind of want to dial back a little bit, because I'm fascinated by your experience with watching your father go through a doctoral program. I had the exact same experience. I was pretty young when my mom got her doctorate, but I do remember that she was busting her butt. Both me and my sister were already born. We're 6 years apart, and I was pretty young. I want to say I was maybe like 9 or 10 when she got her PhD. And it was very... It was a powerful experience. I mean, my mom, and she's not shy about talking about this, and I think it says a lot about how we all in the family prize education. She graduated from high school, has always been brilliant, has always had an affinity for languages. I mean, she has like trenchant, razor sharp wit, but left high school and was working at McDonald's. And my dad, I guess they had just started dating, and my dad came home from JMU where he was going, and I may have the story slightly wrong, so I would love it if they corrected me on this, but because I'm a collector of history. Yeah. But my dad said, "You're too smart to be working at McDonald's. You have to go to school." And, you know, she cared about him more than she cared about the idea of going to college. And she, you know, knew he was super smart and said, "Okay, you know, I'm going to try this out." She started taking classes at GW and was taking classes for the love of the subject. It wasn't with some, you know, plan in mind that she was going to get a doctorate, and she just kept on taking classes and classes and classes. And she's not the only one. I have a lot of dear friends who it was the same way for them. They basically fell into a doctorate because they were so in love with the subject and with what they were doing that propelled them through that experience, which you and I are both not doctored up, so we can only look in from the outside. But it's a trial by fire. I mean, everybody says you have to have a little bit of psychosis in order to make it through.
And that's like, go ahead. I agree with you.
I think that psychosis is your love of your subject. So I, the entirety of my life, I felt like a terminal degree, and not necessarily an MFA, because I actually was on track for an MFA, and I said, you know what, this isn't totally what I want to do, but I felt like getting that doctorate was important to me, not only because I felt like it would be a meaningful accomplishment in my own journey.
Yeah.
But it was also something that I had witnessed my mom doing, and I'd witnessed other folks in my family doing. And I have a tie to it that is more than just, okay, this is an academic pursuit that I'm going to take part in. It's like I would be contributing to a tradition that my family had already espoused and had bought into, and I would be closer to them in some way for doing it, which is crazy because I've never said those words out loud before, and you're helping me kind of piece this together. I think in some ways, that it would more closely align me to people that I love so very much, and not only yep. because they love me and that they're my family, but because I love who they are and how they think and how they work and yep. what they've done. And yep. I want to be a part of that too. So my only right. struggle with this, and you know, this is a really timely conversation. My only struggle with this is that right now I feel like I'm in the island of misfit toys. Mm. There was a time when an EDD or even a PhD for those few programs that still exist in ed tech would be what I would want to do.
Right.
And I don't feel like that's going to be my story. I don't feel like that's going to be the next chapter of this story. I have been a food blogger since 2008.
Right.
I fell into that too. I was like, who creates blogs? I don't care what you ate for breakfast. I don't care what your cat's doing. Like, blogs are stupid. And then I ended up combating the cold New York winters with a Fresh Direct grocery delivery service that would bring me all sorts of crazy ingredients into my kitchen, and I would create dishes that would challenge me. And then I ended up going into this really cool thing called the Daring Chefs, which is the Daring Kitchen, I'm sorry, which is a secret cooking club online that is mostly populated by people all over the world, particularly in Australia, which is always hilarious when you get recipes from Australians and you have to convert them, which is not a big deal because math is easy with the internet. But the hard part is when they're on opposite seasons than you're on and they want you to do a beef bourguignon challenge in July right. when you're in Phoenix, Arizona.
Like, you're like, hey, yo, that's no, we're going to do some watermelon prosciutto right now.
So, and that's that. Now, actually, mm-hmm. you know, you'll laugh at this. For that particular recipe, we made the beef bourguignon in the crock pot so we didn't heat up the house. And right. then I shredded the beef and wrapped it in crepes with brie and sauteed Ooh. Mushrooms. And I think we did like a watercress Ooh. Thing. So, yeah, we made it happen. Yeah. Oof. And it was just a problem that was waiting to be solved. Like everything that I love in my life, it's just a problem waiting to be solved. So my current problem, and maybe you have some answers for this, is that it would be easy for me to pursue something in ed tech. Mm-hmm. And not to say that a PhD would be easy, but that I mean, maybe it would be the most common sense choice.
so here's kind of the thing about this, right? And I almost don't talk about it because I don't kind of want to out myself on my views on some of this because I have. And I think that's the point, is that I have immense respect for what I saw my dad go through and what I've seen friends and colleagues go through. And yet a lot of them and a lot of people, particularly people that I feel like are in my sphere or circle, as I see them going to go through it and complete it, there's both this immense sense of pride for having done it. And I want to be able to tap into that for myself, but I'm surely for extrinsic reasons too. Mm-hmm. But a lot of them talk about as they go through it that, you know, the culture and of pride around it and those kinds of things are broken and that stuff needs to die. And so I see people talking about, you know, this matters because it's hard, arduous work and the work should drive it. But the privilege that comes with it and kind of just, I don't know, some of that culture around privileging it and privileging how hard it is, people kind of reject that. So I just kind of feel like I've never bought into that only because – and it's not because, oh, I think I'm so smart that it wouldn't be arduous or difficult or draining. Like, it's not that. I know it would be a beast, and as soon as I – you know, I know what I don't know, and then I also don't know what I don't know. But I feel like in my life when I am in that zone
– you're most happy or you're most fulfilled, I should say.
Yeah. Well, and like, man, the game of school, I know this game. And even like as a – as a person who would articulate that I'm like liberated or woke on this school game, like I feel like I can do this, particularly around feeling like I can. That's the hard part, right? Is like there is a gatekeeping element to it. I don't have one, and yet it's a matter of like, well, I just haven't done that yet, is kind of how I look at it. So I have this little chip on my shoulder, but also a respect for it, and it feels complicated. But anyway, that's not even the point I want to make, right? The point I want to make is I haven't done ed tech. Yeah, it feels like it would be the thing, but then it feels like, man, and I, this is not even a knock on Ohio State, but like, I feel like a lot of ed tech programs aren't at the level of stuff that some of us are already doing. You know what I mean? Or at least I feel like what's available to me at Ohio State. And that's what it sounds like is I'm knocking Ohio State for not being any good. And I don't even know.
That's it's just one of those things. That's a national snapshot right now of where ed tech is.
Scholars, think about it. The scholars I want to study with, I'm podcasting with. And I mean that. Like next week, Bonnie Stewart's coming and we're going to hang out. She's the keynote at our conference. Mm-hmm. And like, she's who I want to study with. I want to talk to Jess Knott about LX and UX design. I want to talk, you know, I want to talk with Laura Pasquini. I want to talk with, you know, Roland Moe and like these people. And it's like George Siemens. It's like, well, look, I'm arm's length from these people digitally. So what, you know, that's just kind of the piece, right? Is like, man, the work that I want to do that's engaging and human, I'm kind of already connected to it.
Yeah.
So, but it doesn't get me a credential. Like there, so that's the question, right? Is, and I haven't explored this very hard literally at Ohio State, but I'm also like, I'm kind of bound to being at Ohio State because that's where I am. So yeah, I don't know.
And you love it. I mean, you're underselling your love and commitment to your university right now.
Oh, no doubt. No doubt.
Yeah. I have to put that in there because for those of you that don't know Ben, I mean, he's Ohio through and through, and that's a big part of this puzzle that's being solved. It's almost like, you know, if it were simple, it would already be done, but it wouldn't be as sweet if it were simple.
What I should say is, thanks a lot, Henry McKenna. I'm throwing out a lot of stuff that probably sounds like a lot of hubris. Like, oh, I don't mean that at all. I certainly don't mean to knock the program. I'm so fascinated with this idea of the 21st century and what's actually the kind of work students. I'll just put it this way: in my job, in my office, we have student workers who can do stuff as well or better than a lot of our full-time staff, right?
Yes.
Not a lot of our full-time – again, hubris and blah, blah. Some of our full-time staff – like, but let's just put it this way. Better than me. People who have far more technical skills than I have. And so it is one of this – it's not intimidating per se, but it's like it's really good to know like, hey, you got to go work every day because kids can do this stuff. Did you meet, I'm going to butcher his last name, Reichard or Ricard, Andrew from Davidson and New Orleans 2 weeks ago?
No. And I was following him on, Twitter, but I didn't actually get to physically meet him.
I mean, look, I mean, I just think about this all the time. I went back home and I just thought about this as I was just like, hey, you've seen that this cat is out there, right? Like you've seen that this dude exists. So you're going to see
a real human being.
No, you're going to sleep on your instructional design with this cat out there. It's just kind of one of those things where it's like, so what is the, if I'm going to really engage in scholarship, maybe that's my fear, and this is where it is. It's unfounded, and this is – so I'm speaking out of ignorance, and I recognize this. Like I'm not having any conversations with anyone to say, hey,
I'm really not.
Exactly. I'm not having actually any conversations with our faculty to say, here's my areas of interest. Is this an area that aligns with yours? Could we go push some scholarship in this area? Are you willing to walk down this path?
And that's the way to do it. That is, and all of my my dearest, closest colleagues say, rather than digging around some degree search program, find the people whose ideas and whose research are seductive and sticky to you.
Mm-hmm.
Find those people and do amazing things with them. And learn from them. Learn as much from them as possible. And because hopefully they're going to learn from you, too, in the whole process. So that's where I'm struggling, because I feel like the group that we have formed, and it's a big group and it's an open group. I hate saying group. You know, I struggle with words sometimes because words carry a lot of weight and meaning, and I want them to be precise. So we talk about our tribe, and it makes it seem like it's a clique, and you have to be initiated, and you have to, you know, join in with us, and there's some sort of hazing and whatnot. But really, it's just meeting people that are your people, that when you talk to them in your soul, you're like, we have always been united by thought, and we just have not breathed the same air or shared the same existence yet. But in this moment, we now realize that we're meant to, you know, to do the same kinds of crazy shit that we were dreaming up by ourselves alone. And I think the same thing goes for this. I need to find my tribe for my dissertation committee that I have found in my professional career. And that is an awesome problem to solve, but it's also really troublesome in the sense that I don't want to make a misstep, and I don't want to jump the gun.
Right.
And I don't think that could happen. I mean, I give myself a lot of credit. I give the people around me a lot of credit. I think I'll know. It's like falling in love, you know, when you know. Mm-hmm. And maybe it's the same way for finding your perfect dissertation committee. But really and truly, I mean, it's just the people that are going to help me unpack some of these crazy jumbled ideas. So I'll give you my crazy jumbled idea. I'm going to throw this out in the universe. And before I give you my jumbled idea, I just want to bookend the story that I was telling you in the beginning. I was a webmaster for 15 years and was a back alley instructional designer for that entire time because I knew technology, and people that I cared about that were in higher ed would ask me questions about their courses, and I would go in and help them and work as an instructional technologist, but then would get a little bit more and more into the pedagogy and, I mean, really and truly the andragogy. And you know, I would poke around more and more. And when I got to ASU, I said, you know what, I'm going to take some classes, and I think I'm going to take them in the education technology program because it sounds cool. Mm-hmm. And really what it wasn't so much education technology. It was an instructional design program. And at that moment, I had the Dorothy arriving in Oz and seeing everything in color moment. And what had happened was that not only had I come full circle for the science, which I had not had since I left my pre-med program, my first year of being an undergrad at Fordham, but I also realized that everything that I had learned for those 15 years about visual communications and the way people think and the way people make choices and the way that you talk to folks to persuade them and, but more importantly, compel them to action, all had to do with cog-sci research that came from the instructional design realm that was being fed to me through this program. And, you know, the clouds parted and the angels sang, and, you know, I knew that this is where I needed to be. And that was, 5 years ago. And even looking back at that, I mean, all the things that I've learned, you know, you don't stop and reflect and think about your gratitude list in terms of all of the people that even came after you get the masters. You know, you don't go through that list like you just did for me, Ben, where you said the people that I want to learn from are the people that I'm podcasting with. Yep. We don't do that actively, and we need to. because they're defining the courses of our lives. I mean,
No. Right. Yeah. Well, and here's the other thing is like, and I thought about this on the way. So we spent a lot of like the last, and it started early in New Orleans, right? Like the last 24 hours was like, oh, we're already going to leave tomorrow. How do we take this home? How do we keep that going? And I think we were a little bit more intentional going after it this time, which was, hey, you know, we actually are already doing it. And so that's part of like,
yes,
part of how I feel is like, hey, you're already doing the thing. Like that was the question on the plane home is like, are you living the life you want to live? And it got like that deep. It really did get like, mm-hmm. you know, and I mean, you know, you're flying over the Great Smoky Mountains. That's going to happen to you, but it really got,
you're going to get winsome. You're going to hear fleet foxes in your ear.
But it really did turn into like, well, what would be different about what you're into right now? And it was just like, yeah, man, I feel at home just in the last couple of months of like just engaging and finding those people that I have affinity for.
Yeah.
And so like,
well, I would posit that even in our moments of struggle and, you know, in the darkest hours where we're muddled and our brains hurt and not necessarily in a good way, that we're still engaged. We're still engaged with all those other folks, certainly, but we're not being intentional about calling them out and the meaning and the, and the importance of keeping those connections going. So that's all we're doing. We're just calling them out. We're calling out folks. So anyway, crazy idea. Drum roll. I'm a food blogger.
Yep.
I'm an instructional designer who's fascinated with digital storytelling. My only true, like, soul-scratching love for history comes from food history and the way that culture is built around food memories, and particularly the practice of creating dishes and learning how to cook and carrying around those oral traditions that come from the kitchen and come from the people that we care about in the kitchen. So in the same way that I had my Dorothy and Oz moment for instructional design, where I could be a person that was an artist and was a scientist and was an educator and was a programmer and could wear all of those hats simultaneously, and nobody would bat an eyelash at me for doing all of those things or call me a dilettante for doing all of those things. Why can't I do that with the one thing that I am most consistently passionate about? And that's preserving these cultural traditions through food.
Yep. And so isn't that it, right? Isn't that the answer? It's like, hey, and this is the thing I would be curious. I'm better when I'm curious as opposed to when I presume I know stuff I don't know.
We all are.
And that's a fine line of when I'm doing that. But I would be really curious to ask Jess and to ask a guy who I met in New Orleans a couple weeks ago. Dude, I love John Stewart at Oklahoma. Would really love to pick his brain on this. It's like, so what changed, like, maybe when – because when you finished and you've got your PhD, right? Like, because I feel like, think about what you're doing. Like, I mean, there are, I mean, that's culture, that's history, that's rich, and you're living it, right? You're doing it. And that's the most powerful form of learning. Like, and mm-hmm. if you're being honest with yourself, the difference between you and somebody on Food Network right now is literally access to the Food Network studio in some regard. And like, I think that's one of the things I feel like I felt like this in college and undergrad, where I had buddies who were – I have a bunch of buddies who are incredibly musically talented, like mm-hmm. the kind of thing that's like – and lots of people can be that, and I'm not – even arguing that these guys are world-class special. They're probably not, or they are not, I guess.
They probably are, actually, Ben.
But here's the thing about it is like, that's a beautiful thing, not necessarily something to gatekeep, right? Is like how good you are at a thing. Maybe when you're talking about like the Billboard Top 200 or making money at it or something like that. But we would talk all the time about the difference between, you know, bands that make it and people that don't. A lot of times it's just, you know, it's sure there's chance, there's a chance in everything, but also just the persistence to commit to that and the opportunity. But like one of my absolute all-time favorite songs is a song by Wilco called The Late Greats, and it essentially has all these lyrics that, you know, the best song will never get sung, you know, the basically the greatest band in rock and roll, you'll never hear them because the singer looked a little too old. And it's just kind of like there's just all these interesting ideas that what I wonder is you are doing those things. Do you feel accomplished and fulfilled in the doing? And that's what I challenge myself is a lot of times I look around at my life and feel like, oh, I'm capable of so much, but no one's recognizing me. Right. And then you just turn your head and you're like, well, you know, that's kind of how that works, right? Like, what are you upset about? You have an incredible life with incredibly fulfilling relationships. So maybe this is just all my therapy about why I think I'm great and no one else is. But like, that is actually a little bit connected to what I think is really great about this moment right now is I'm connecting with you all and saying, man, we're doing stuff that's important and that matters. And I'm happy to be in this community. And that's fulfilling.
So it goes back to that whole idea of funds of knowledge and that, we all have value and worth, whether we're, you know, on the top of the ivory tower, whether we're, at the very bottom of it and told that we're never going to be a part of it. And, there was an interesting thing that happened. So, I connected with, and I'm trying to think about what year it was. Oh, gosh. I think it was about 2010. So I'd been food blogging for 2 years. I had known my buddy Tim Ma, who's actually a pretty well-known chef in the Washington, D.C. area. I'm underselling him. His restaurants have been on the Washingtonian best list, the Northern Virginia Magazine best list. I mean, he's a big deal. But I knew him as an engineer that worked at Raytheon back in the day that really loved food and gave it all up with his then girlfriend, now wife, to go to cooking school, to get an externship at a big deal restaurant in New York City, to go to the Virgin Islands and then say, you know what, I'm going to do this on my own terms and I'm going to max out my credit card, her credit card. Yep. We're going to sell every last car. We're going to beg every last person for a bit of change to start up a restaurant. So, let me think about this. 4 restaurants later, he's living his dream. He works harder than anybody that I'd ever know. Some people might look at his life and not think it's a dream.
Right.
But it came from this dedication and commitment to elevating food. And really, it was like a puzzle just waiting to be solved. I think with that same engineering brain that he's always had, nothing ever changed. And when he first started with his first restaurant, Maple Ave, he and I connected over food, and which is kind of a remarkable thing. If you've been somebody's friend for how long, you've known them in one context. He knew me as a web designer. I knew him as an engineer. And all of a sudden we're bonding over this just total love and passion for the kitchen. We started to write a cookbook together and we did it on opposite coasts of the country. And the question that kept on coming up from him to me was, why did I not want to become a chef? Why did I not want to study how to do that and go through that process if I really love food as much as I did? And I think for me, my love of food comes from a place that's similar to my love of education. There's that moment when people realize that their story is unique and valued and powerful and super compelling. And that happens in the classroom a whole lot when we give our students the opportunity to guide the learning, still meeting the same learning outcomes, but getting to that, to that that place that we want them to be at. It happens in the kitchen too. When you ask people, okay, when did you learn to do this? Or what was that one recipe that when you perfected it, it was a fucking masterpiece. And did you intend that, or did you know that it was going to be a masterpiece as you were going about it? Or was it purely kismet that you fell upon the solution to this problem? And what does that mean to you? And if you see something, or if you smell something, or if you get a little bit of a taste of something and it triggers all of these memories that are linked to all of these memories before that, tell me about that. Dig into that. That excitement, that curiosity, that passion, the science that comes with it, the art that comes with it, is the most pure mapping of me.
Yep.
You know, we're complex beings, and we have all of these interests and passions, and I think that anything that we can do that will celebrate all of them, or as many of them as possible, I mean, that's like mainlining heroin, you know? It's just...
Except for that, it makes you live as opposed to kills you. But
exactly. Listen. No minus the monkey on your back. I'm not advocating chasing the dragon, folks. But
listen, we're just substantive differences aside. You get the point.
Yes.
No. That's great. Well, so here's what I want to ask you then, because we didn't get to any of the topics. I'm going to try to catch Dave tomorrow.
I disagree.
Correct. Let me put it this way.
We hit empathy hard.
I think that I care in any way, shape, or form. if you don't feel like you're going to get there, let's say in a nice, none of our answers are nice and concise, but if you feel like this is a larger conversation and not a response, then that's fine. We can do this later. But what, just in your life, like, I don't know, broadly, is, you know, education, and maybe you don't have a narrative for this, but maybe you do. But to me, it feels like I've been honing a really crystallized picture of why education has been just such a anchor in my life, or why I feel like my life is so kind of enamored with it, such a believer in it. And I just wonder for you, I and I'm thinking about your parents and some of your stories, and maybe there's a connection, but is there, just tying this maybe back up to your earlier story, is there something about education that you say this is why I'm in this. Maybe connecting the dots backward. Is it education in particular, or is it just kind of where you've ended up?
I think it's education, certainly. And again, education broader than the brick and mortar classroom. But for me, a whole lot of folks, particularly my mother and my father, but many, many other folks along the way, handed me gifts that I did not understand the magnitude of them when I received them. But I took them and I used them, and I was able to continue my journey. And it was a journey that I was in charge of, for sure. You know, they didn't give me all the things that they gave me with any sort of prescriptive intent as to how it would all go. They gave selflessly, and they gave openly, and they said, "We want you to go forth and do majestic things."
Yeah.
And I don't want to get emotional, but I'm humbled, and I'm grateful for them, for kicking that off. And I know you get that too. And, I think that if we never know in this life when we're going to be of service to people, And I just want to be of service to as many people as possible in the same way that they and all of the other people were of service to me. And that's the bare minimum, Ben. That's the bare minimum that I could possibly do in this life. So when we talk about, am I doing it? Am I living a life that I want to live? As long as I'm of service to the folks that are around me and helping them get to where they need to be, then I'm living the best fucking life I could possibly live.
Yeah, no, it's no, it's powerful, right? So gratitude, right, is like the highest state of emotional intelligence, right? If you can live in a life of gratitude. But then I see it in one of my very best friends who started this nonprofit that I'm affiliated with and jump in, and now we're all full steam ahead. But I actually think there's one above that, right? Which is, there's gratitude, and then there's gratitude that compels you to pay it forward. And I actually feel like paying it forward is like the highest level of emotional intelligence, maybe, or just like fulfillment of purpose. So yeah. No, to hear you say it, it's like, yeah, you should. That's awesome. Like, you should be emotional about that. That's like, not only is that a life's work, it is, you know, life in service of making things better for other people is like, I don't know, man. I think a lot about, like, you know, when you
I'm raising my drink to you.
Yeah, right now. When you get in that level of spiritual stuff, it's like that. Yeah. When you start talking about purpose and it kind of just like the finite nature of like just this existence, like that's a good way to go. Well, let's put it this way. You see a lot of messages every day that don't naturally point you in that direction. All of us. And so anyway, that resonates with me. So I'm cool with that. Well, we did it.
We did a lot.
We did it. Well, look, listen,
we didn't burn it down. I may or may not have encouraged heroin usage by accident. I'm so sorry.
I insulted every PhD in the history of PhDs. Yeah, we stood up and then we wound up at the end a little bit misty over the power of education. So we really did it tonight. But yeah, I'll see if Dave and I can actually burn it down tomorrow. I'll cobble this together sometime and then we'll do it. But no, this has been. We're going to keep doing this, but this has been – this is great, so I really appreciate it.
This is a really good thing. Thank you, Ben, for making it happen. I get to pick your brain next time.
You got it. That lists
21 questions with Ben Scragg.
I'm shy and I don't talk much, so
– None of them will be about bourbon. Cool. All of them will be about bacon.
Absolutely. Listen, bacon, beards, bourbon, and babies. That's everything I know everything about.
Right. My only regret on this podcast was that we didn't get your sweet little daughter's voice on any of the recording. I heard her before, and for shame, Ben, for shame.
Is she sleeping? Lord willing. Well, I'm about to listen. I've been up here for an hour. I think at this point I'm compelled to go find out for better or for worse. But yeah, and we'll fill that in with old David R. Goodrich tomorrow.
Hi-o. What's his middle name? Richard?
Just Ranger.
Ranger, as in Walker, Texas Ranger.
As in Ranger Davey. That's the only way I know him. So
I like to imagine that he has two other brothers, and one's middle name is Walker, and the other one's middle name is Texas. Well, you should ask him about that next time.
Actually, I may. That's great.
All right, my friend.
All right, I will talk to you soon. Travel safe.
Thank you.
All right. Bye.
Bye.
We're rocking and rolling?
We are indeed.
Okay, so I got to ask. So last week was kind of like an avalanche week. Returning to work, it sounded like. It was kind of like wham bam.
Indeed.
How about this week?
This week has actually gotten a bit busier because our annual
EdTech conference at Ohio State, which is also known as Innovate, is next Wednesday. It's less than a week away.
Yes, it is.
I am serving as the co-chair for the conference this year, a kind of chair in residency. And next year will be a full-blooded chair. And so we've been doing a lot of prep, including a very new feature at the conference this year that we're very excited about, called Fund My Idea. And I'm primarily, I suppose, a point person for leading that session. And so it's all come together kind of at the end. I think it's fair to say that that has come together kind of late, and it's because strategically we're in some ways reorganizing our grants program, which is funding this, and we've all kind of had crazy schedules. So, and the interesting thing is the folks that won have had very interesting, challenging kind of ideas. The idea is it's a small innovation grant, and we're going to help fund some people, but it's been busy. So to the answer to the question is it's been busy. And when I get busy, I get a little bit scatterbrained, or I have a propensity for that in my personal life. And so I lost my, I lost my eyeglasses today, this afternoon.
Oh no.
So I have prescription sunglasses. So I'm sitting with my prescription sunglasses on, and my glasses are, they're gone. They're not certainly, they're gone. I've spent hours looking for them tonight. And they're gone. And so I'm a little now more stressed out about the prospect of going the next week, alternating between wearing sunglasses indoors when I have to be able to see versus just winging it when I don't. So, things are great.
Do you wear contacts?
I don't. No? I don't.
Oh, okay.
I probably should, but I don't.
Oh man, that's not fun.
We're gonna get there though. That was. I've laid my troubles upon you, and now I'm committed to victory.
But you do know, I mean, sunshades are the emblem of success and heroism and fame. So
I buy that. I buy that.
It is appropriate, I think.
So it's worth asking you. You're feeling better. Are you? Would you put yourself at 81%? Are you 100%?
Yeah. Like today, it kind of has gone in waves, energy wise. But yesterday was just like I was out all day. Just kind of like a 24-hour flu bug, nasty, not fun. But I'm back at it, back in the game. Tripped over some bleachers a couple times, ran into a cheerleader or two, or, you know, well, the game analogy is not working well.
It's all right. We're just workshopping stuff here, and you ideated and came after it. Well, we had Angela and I had a great chat last night, and I'll be really interested to see how this comes together. Did you listen to our chat?
No, I haven't yet. Want to.
Totally fine. I don't even know. Yeah, I got to give you access to that. I think it. We did it on my Zencastr account. We're doing this one on yours. I may just dump those files over to you and see if you want to parse through. Although, Angela and I were very much enjoying some libations, and we didn't talk about really any of the things that I think we'd planned to talk about. I just started wanting to pick her brain about a couple of elements, and it got pretty deep.
Nice.
I think it's fair to say at the end that Angela was crying. And not because I made her cry.
Serious.
yeah. So we'll just have to see how we piece that together. And I don't know if you and I are headed on that trajectory, but I will share with you where we started, which was, you know, I was just a little bit curious about who she is and where, kind of how, what her path has been and what her passion for this kind of work is. And then just kind of weaving our way through that together. And one piece in particular is the kind of the piece that's I feel like is out there for both of us, she and I, which is our doctoral programs. And so we spent some time just talking about how we both kind of have a dream for that. We both have parents who completed those and went that route. And so in some sense, it feels like that is a hurdle, maybe, in a good way, right? Psychologically, like the thing to chase, or the standard that was set, or something like that. So I don't know. I don't know if any of that interests you, but I would be interested if you have a few minutes just to kind of hear what your journey's been, where you find yourself right now in this work, and maybe even education writ large, why you're passionate about it.
Yeah, you know, it's I was one of those students that annoyed my teachers probably a lot in high school, especially because I was one of those students that asked why a lot and was kind of a, you know, your class clown kind of thing. Didn't do super good with grades, was more interested in learning outside of formal learning environments. But I had some teachers that were rock solid and really, really good and really inspiring. And they are the reason that I, even in high school, knew that I wanted to become a teacher. So that's what I did. I became a teacher. And then I realized, whoa, all the hell that I put my own teachers through.
Right.
And
right. Yeah, there is karmic activity there.
Yes, right? Karma was definitely raining upon me. And I learned very quickly how huge and meaningful and important the work of the teacher is. And burn out pretty quick in that. But knew I was down for the count, but I knew I was going to get back up. And I have to throw my life at education, because I can't help but look at it and see what it's done for me and what it does for people in terms of freeing them at the core of their being sometimes, and at the mind level. And so it's important to me.
Well, one other question may be related back to interested in learning, maybe as opposed to grades and some of those more formal experiences. Was there a moment or set of moments, or even an active kind of ongoing awareness of your contempt for the structures of, let's say, grading and schooling, as we would call it, while you were a high school student? Like, did you actively kind of get like, hey, I like this learning and I like doing these things, but I don't like the school business?
You know, I've always had like an interesting relationship with formal education. And I think I probably trace it back to piano lessons. My parents wanted me to take piano lessons. So I took them. I hated them. Just not fun. But they noticed, like, while I was supposed to be practicing, I was listening to stuff and, you know, playing things by ear, and spent a lot of my time practicing just, you know, playing things by ear and not necessarily paying attention to the music that I was supposed to be reading, you know, kind of thing. So I have really cool parents who caught onto that real quickly and were able to somehow find like a piano teacher who like specialized in helping students tap into playing by ear and learning scales. Mm-hmm. And it was just kind of a different approach to learning music. And that really jived with how I went about it.
Opened up some doors.
It really did. Yeah. Now, looking back on it,
doors of learning.
Yeah, totally. Looking back on it, like I look at people who can read music and can look at a sheet of music and like make it their own in real time. Like, I look at that and major jealousy. So like, So I have come to learn the extreme value of formal education, and that it is a discipline that has great value. It's just not something that I naturally gravitate toward, but it is something that I hugely value and have great respect for.
That's interesting. I'll respond that I had some very crystalline experiences in my mind toward my junior, maybe senior year of high school. They bled together because they were the same teacher, my math teacher. I took pre-calculus and calculus my junior and senior years of high school, not because I was particularly interested in them, but because they were the hardest courses the high school offered. And
yeah,
everyone said, if you want to get into college, you should take harder classes. And
yeah,
all the other kids who were generally high achieving, right, because I thought in those kinds of terms, were taking them. And so, of course, I was going to take them. And then got into that class, and I was always so... I fretted so much about my grades, and of course, I was a really good student grade-wise. And I ran into this class, and it was really hard, and I began to really resent working hard because it was tied to, felt like it was tied to grades and competing with classmates. And and I just remember there was one exam. Everyone in the class did really poorly on it, and it was probably halfway through my junior year. Everyone did really poorly on it. And I got a 21% on this pre-calculus, you know, chapter exam or unit exam or something. And there were kids in the room who were in tears. And I was just, it was so bad that I just kind of instantly was like, there's no way I'm actually going to live with this. Like, I've got to figure something out, right? Like, I'll do something. There's no way I can let this ride, right? Like, I was kind of numb to it. Mm-hmm. But there were kids crying in my class, my classmates, my friends. And I got it, right? Like, I totally got it. These were other kids who had 4.0s and stuff. I didn't, but... And I just remember Mr. Cunningham. This guy was awesome. He was our student council advisor. And kind of, at the time, seemed like kind of a rebel teacher, and in one of the ways, it's one of the things that made him great. Well, I was just telling a friend about this the other day, but he kind of looked at us all and just with exasperation was just kind of like, stop it. Like, why are you so upset? Here, let's just do this. What you're upset about, you're upset about your grades, but you don't care about your learning. So let me just, here, take a 21% now an A or whatever it was. Just take your A's. Take your A's and A minuses and B's. Are you happy now? And everyone kind of quit crying. And of course, on the inside, right, it's like, no. But of course, the answer was, yeah. And he just said, you haven't learned anything new. You know, why? None of you are cared about whether or not you learn this stuff. You no care about the next thing that's coming up. And he just kind of opened up this world, right? That, like, my job, what this test means is that I didn't do a good enough job teaching you. You didn't do a good enough job learning. We're not done here. And we're going to go back and you're going to retake this test, all of you. And when I'm tossing this grade out so you can dry up your tears and let's get to work. Mm. And it was just kind of, you know, no one had ever done that in 11 or 12 years of schooling. And it was this really formative moment that when I got to the point in college, I started as a journalism major where I wanted to get into that, you know, into teaching or become an education major. It was like, I only want to do this if we don't put kids through this game that their life is attached to their grades. And then that becomes the signifier for what matters and their worth. And so we just, that was really powerful. So I don't know. I wonder how much that connects to the formal structures and those kinds of things. I think there's something very liberating in learning, but I think there's something even more maybe liberating in, for me anyway, in being curious about how I was learning or how I was approaching my learning. And so, yeah, I don't know if that resonates with you at all, but I was thinking about that.
It totally resonates. I mean, it was actually my math teacher too, who was actually my basketball coach all through high school too. Who also brought, like, the passion for learning itself into the classroom, and helped also peer through the windows of the formalities of grades and understand that that's not what it's about. I don't remember like a specific moment like that where he called us out. That's really cool that your math teacher did that and that like you remember that really clearly. But it was more of just kind of like a thing that he returned to again and again, and that like the important thing is to continue learning. That was
I had a similar experience in college in a junior senior year in an education course. It was a education and society course, and the instructor kicked everyone out because we all came to class unprepared. We hadn't read. And he was insulted. He made a big show about being insulted. And I think about this to this day is like he didn't do it as an exercise of power in the sense that like he's like, I don't care about your grade. This doesn't affect your grade. You're probably all getting A's. You all do everything I say when it comes to the assignments except this one thing, which is you don't think. And that's what this is about. This is about you thinking. This is not about you pleasing me. But since you don't get that, let me share this with you. I'm very displeased. You haven't read. You haven't prepared. Get out. And guess what? Don't come back until you are. And I don't care if you don't come back. Wow. If you don't come back and you still want your A, just shoot me an email. I'll be happy to do that. And I think it was...
Wow.
It was probably pretty ballsy, right? But there seems that way now. But then it made me, it made me hungry. And this was a guy who was confrontational in a way of like disrupting my psyche. Cause we talked about ideas that, I believed in equality and we talked about things like institutional racism and power structures and thing, uncomfortable truths to me. That I wanted to argue with, and it was one of those first times that somebody let me wrestle with things, too. And it was just like those experiences of having what I think are real education, right? I think the I'm just rambling here, but it brings me to this other thing that I'm curious about. Well, let me stop there because there's another thread here, but I just wonder, for you, what has shaped – so maybe there are early piano lessons – but even let's say more recently, as you've moved into the role you're in now, like what is shaping your view of what education is and should be?
lots of things, lots of people writing about it, thinking about it out loud, teaching about it. Lots of people I respect in the field are continuing to shape my thinking about it, but also just I'm, as you know, a part of the Hub for Innovation and Learning and Technology at MSU, and there's been I've been doing instructional design for 8 years or so now, and all along there's always been this interest in changes that could be made at a larger level than myself or the teams I've been a part of. And I've been a part of amazing teams, doing instructional design. But I've always kind of dreamed of, there being an organization, kind of that has been supported at the highest levels of leadership in an organization that really has a vision toward innovation and real meaningful change for student experiences. And just being a part of that right now is something that's really exciting. And seeing the connections that are being made already real early on is just thrilling and scary and exciting all at the same time. So, right now, being in the midst of some really exciting major changes that are beginning to take place and conversations that are starting and projects that are emerging from that are really shaping me probably more than anything else at an experiential level.
Yeah, wow. So I'll jump back to a thought I had earlier, which is thinking about those classes. I remember college. I remember a moment in college where I was wrestling with things. There was cognitive dissonance. I was recognizing it. I was holding two different ideas in my head and evaluating them. And I always kind of do that. I think that, and that's not, probably comes across as a brag or a humble brag, but I feel like somewhere along the line, it was training to try to see the best version of the argument for different sides of things, and maybe not two. Maybe it's not quite so dialectic. But I remember thinking, like, well, I changed my mind about a lot of stuff because I thought about it.
Mm, yeah.
And I wonder if other people do that. And that's obviously, I think that's a right approach, or I wouldn't think it right. I mean, like, a thing I like to sit around and say sometimes when we're having these kind of conversations is, of course, I think what I think is right, or I would think some other thing, I guess. And that doesn't necessarily maybe mean I am right, or presume that maybe it gets a little bit relativistic for other people can certainly think what they want and often do, always do. But I guess I just get curious when I see, maybe it's our current political climate, maybe it's social media, but pick your brain. Do you think it's relevant, necessary at this point? I'm just going to ping you with this idea and then just get your opinion on it. But sometimes I feel really discouraged when I look at my role in education and feeling like, how do we help people get to a place where they think and be willing to change their mind if need be, or adopt something new? And maybe it happens all the time and I just don't look at it because the shouting heads maybe on the news networks are always the same. But yeah. I think about that all the time. It's like, maybe it's very rare for people to be persuaded by others. I don't know.
Yeah, and I think that's probably why you and I are have thrown our lives into the world of education, because you and I probably have had rare experiences with really passionate and notable instructors who have really, and it sounds like from what you described earlier, like done some things in their instruction that were really shocking and memorable, and created a learning experience that it's hard for you to shake for the rest of your life, kind of thing. I think that involves emotions and a really good, it's such an art, isn't it? I mean, a really good sense of what I think of as maybe Vygotsky's zone of proximal development, like understanding how much you can push somebody where you don't push them so hard that you break them, but you also don't under push them so that they're not challenged, and doing that at a class level too, like that takes some major skills.
Yeah.
Major skills.
Yeah.
Yeah, that are oftentimes not really appreciated. Like, and I think, you know, a lot of times teachers are, instructors, faculty are oftentimes misunderstood, but underappreciated for the major work it takes to cultivate that kind of learning environment. Yeah. And largely because not all teachers do that, you know. So
yeah.
But you and I are fortunate that we've had experiences like that have been truly transformative, to the point where we're like, yeah, we want to be a part of something like that in other people's lives too.
I think that's an interesting, well, let me, and maybe this is fodder for editing or maybe it's not, but if I'm piecing together, and the other thing I will share with you is Angela and I talked for an hour. I may jump here relatively soon if that's all right.
Oh, with you. I'm the same way.
In thinking about where Angela and I picked things up last night, or in thinking about where Angela and I kind of went last night in our discussion and where you and I have picked things up, I think we certainly haven't talked as much about design thinking, the process of the conference, but there has been this really interesting kind of groundwork that we're laying for maybe what education means and the power of it in our lives and why we're spending our lives kind of in this field. And I think that's one of the things Angela and I both said is, you know, it sounds like you've been at Michigan State around the same length of time I've been at Ohio State, you know, closer to 10 years than not. And, or at least in this field of higher ed and instructional design and et cetera. And so I think there's something very powerful that, you know, maybe the road isn't always at these institutions. Although Angela said something to me last night. She said, I know you love Ohio State. I know you love that place. And I was just thinking, as soon as she said that, I was thinking about you, you know, and I was like, well, and Dave loves Michigan State, you know, and then you meet Jess and you meet people who are passionate about their institution. My boss, Corey, loves Ohio State maybe as much as anybody I've ever seen. And so like, it's kind of refreshing to work around people who haven't, you know, you have an affinity. And I think institutions, I mean, there's always dangers with institutions, right? But I think colleges and schools engender that in a way that feels a little more easy to wrap your arms around maybe than, let's say, a private institution or a company. Not not a private institution in the sense of school, but it's just interesting to think about that, you know, our lives are somehow geared toward this, so...
Yeah.
I don't know if this was all just a big aside that would make for nice editing, or if it where we patch these things together. But it's interesting, the threads here.
It totally is. Yeah, I think we should definitely run with that conversation about the vocation that we find ourselves in, and you know, why we do what we do. I think that's especially, it's something I'd love to learn more about from you and Angela, because, you know, people who are doing it for really important reasons really do stand out. So,
well, yeah, I mean, one area where it's become really important at Ohio State lately, I think, is the land grant institution mission, and Michigan State's also a land grant. And so it's just kind of one of those pieces when I think about the work that we do in K-12 and bridging higher ed and in K-12, is our impact really does reach the state. And that's one thing at Ohio State. And I don't know if you're seeing this at Michigan State also, but Ohio State's getting much more competitive in its admissions. And so we're hearing from folks around the state that's saying, hey, you know, you're a flagship state university here, and you're not admitting Ohio students because Ohio students aren't getting onto your main campus. And so we've really had to look at, you know, how are we serving the state? And so I think the work I've been doing lately on our, particularly on our grant, working with faculty and working with K-12 teachers and districts around the state, makes it feel like I feel back, like, oh, we're back to that mission. And in my little corner of the world is back to that mission, right? The whole university has incredible, you know, broad reach across the state. But that piece for me in particular, do you see yourself connected to the state of Michigan in your work more broadly?
I do. And I think I can save some of that reason why for a future conversation, because it's probably going to be a little long-winded. But I do, and sure. I think that would be, I think that naturally has come up in our conversations and is definitely something we should run with talking about a lot, because as you know, there's a major divide between K-12 and higher ed. There just is. There's a wall.
Yes, sir.
There's a wall. And I know you, as a major Trump supporter, want to talk about the wall. But
I tell you what, any chance I get, particularly on this Cinco de Mayo, I think it's most fitting to talk about. So I hear what you're saying, and that's great.
No, there's a major wall, and I think that there's so much potential for K-12 and higher ed to have a symbiotic relationship, more so than there is currently. And I'd love to explore that further with you guys.
Well, that, I think that sounds wonderful. Are you, I mean, I'm in, is what I'm saying. Are you comfortable putting a little coda on this tonight and jumping back at this next week?
Absolutely. Let's do it.
Cool.
Yeah. All right. Thanks much, man. Talk to you later. Bye.